Joining us today on Big Game Talk is a UFC fighter with a professional record of 33 wins and 13 losses. He's slated to kick off UFC 249, and his nickname speaks for itself. Smiling Sam Alvey, welcome to the show.
Hey, thank you so much for having me on.
Yeah, thanks for coming on, man. So right now you're slated to fight May 9th against Ryan Spann. So first of all, how do you feel about that matchup?
Well, I love the matchup. I think it's going to be a fantastic fight. You got two guys that hit pretty hard and do all right with their submissions as well.
Good. Now, what area of his game makes you think that you can beat him?
I'd like to think just about every area of his game, but I think the same thing about most people. Every area, I'm better than most people at most things. I just got to make sure I show up and prove it that day.
That's fair. So there's nothing you really feel like you have to avoid in this fight. It's just go out, put on your best performance, and you think that's enough to beat him, eh?
He's got a hell of a guillotine. I think he's got 16 wins, and it's like 9 of them are by guillotine or something close to that. Mm-hmm. He's just a big dude. He's 6'5". He's got like an 81-inch reach. He's a big fella. And me, I was supposed to fight Khalil Roundtree first. And then that fight got canceled, and then it got canceled again. Then I was supposed to fight Ryan Spann, and then that fight got canceled. Now I got Ryan Spann again. So it's been a chaotic month of training, not knowing who I was getting ready for. But he's gonna be a big guy. And like they say, the bigger they are, the harder they fall.
That's awesome. Now, you talked about just all the unpredictability about your training. Like, you don't know who you're going to fight. And also, I mean, you're dealing with all this coronavirus stuff going on. How has the coronavirus affected your training?
It hasn't affected my training at all. I haven't missed a day. I've been working out about twice a day since November. I feel great. My training partners have been plentiful and just getting better with every day.
Have you had to make any adjustments at the gym with all this social distancing stuff, or has it been almost business as usual?
It's been business as usual. I haven't had to teach as many or any kids classes, which I do miss. But as far as training goes, nothing has changed for me.
Now, how are you traveling to Jacksonville for the fight?
I was thinking about walking. I think I get out there next Monday or Tuesday, so something like that. They'll fly me out there, and then I'll kind of see what happens when I'm there. I'm not really sure what to expect with everything being closed down like it is.
Yeah. Is there any fears about flying with the coronavirus stuff because of how kind of confined a plane would be?
I have zero fears about anything corona related.
Fair enough.
Yeah. So they can fly me next to, they can fly me, they can drive me, they can do whatever. I'll be all right.
And you'll be able to go with your full team, right?
I'll be able to go with everyone that needs to go. Yeah. So my kids, I think you're going to get out there for this. My wife is, you know, my chief corner. She'll be out there. Then I'll have my boxing coach, jiu-jitsu coaches. We'll be out there and ready for action.
That's fair. Now, this fight's been kind of canceled on you a few times. Did you, for when this fight card was announced, did you go to the UFC wanting to be on this first fight coming out of this quarantine, or did they approach you?
They approached me, and we were kind of expecting it because in the last month I've had 3 fights fall through. Mm-hmm. Because of different circumstances. But but when they finally had something nailed down, they reached out to me and asked if we'd be willing to do it. We said absolutely without hesitation.
Now, how does it feel to be a part of sports history by kicking off the first fight since the shutdown?
I'm so excited about this. This is my 19th fight in the UFC. I have never been the first fight on a card. And now I'm not only the first fight on the card, I am the first athletic endeavor since late February. Nobody has done anything in the entire world in any sport, and I get to be the first one.
Do you feel like this is a big time showcase where you can kind of show off your skills and show yourself to the whole world, really?
Absolutely. I'm going to be able to get out there and I mean, the eyes of the world are going to be on me, and I'm not going to waste the opportunity.
Now, what would you say to somebody criticizing you for the safety factor of taking this fight?
What would I say to him personally or over the internet?
Fair enough.
Yeah, I'd say keep your mind your business, my man. There are plenty of things going on. We're taking every precaution required of us, and that there's little to no danger of anyone involved.
Now, how confident are you and really the UFC overall that this fight card takes place after the last time it was canceled?
We're 100% in. The governor is on board. The mayor is on board. The athletic commission is on board. Everybody's on board with this fight. And on top of that, Florida itself has opened its doors to all sporting events without a crowd.
That's awesome.
So Florida is back in action too.
Now, did you cancel your Disney Plus membership after the last one got canceled?
No. You see, I get it for free. I'm part of Verizon, so I get it free for a year.
Oh, so nice.
Yeah.
That's awesome. Now, for your MMA career, you've had 46 fights. You said this will be your 19th in the UFC. Is there one fight in particular that stands out as your most memorable or special fight?
Oh. No, the one I remember the best is my first professional loss. It was against Caleb Nelson. I was on, I think, an 11 or 12 fight streak. I was just beating everyone, and I lost to him. And I remember that I lost to him. I beat him up. He beat me up. He won the decision. And I went into the back. I threw up. And then the very next day, I graduated college. I got to walk across the stage all black and blue.
Wow. That's an awesome story there.
Yeah.
Now,
sorry. Oh, you've fought at middleweight, welterweight, and light heavyweight. How has your game had to evolve as you've moved through these different weight classes?
I've also fought heavyweight a couple of times. You know what? The evolution, the game plan, it's never really any different. It's just wherever the UFC wants me, I'm happy to go. Mm-hmm. Maybe at 170, I wasn't happy. But I was willing. Mm-hmm. At 185, I could get back there if they need me to, but I'm pretty comfortable at 205.
That's fair. Do you feel like when you go up in weight, you give up some of your speed to gain more power, or do you think you carry the same speed up?
I feel I'm just as fast and powerful in every weight class I fought in. I've got knockouts in four different weight classes. There's not many people that can say that.
Yeah, that so kind of speaks for itself.
I feel just as fast and as strong in every weight class.
Now, you talked about the knockouts. You have 19 career knockouts. Like, when you go into a fight, is that what you're looking for most of the time?
I'm always looking for knockouts. That's what the fans want to see. I want to give the fans what they want. And knockouts tend to be what gets them, you know, off their butts the fastest. So I've always had a proclivity to knocking people out. And as long as that's what people want to see, that's what I'm going to keep trying to give them.
Now, you've also had some pretty busy spurts during your career, including a 12-month period where you fought 6 times and 3 times in 3 months. Now, how was your body feeling after that stretch?
I took my bumps and bruises, but that's not even the busiest, you know, year of my career. I had one year I fought 11 times in 12 months. That just wasn't in the UFC. I was working to get to the UFC. I took my bumps and bruises there too, but I was never too injured to do another one. This last year was like, this is the slowest year of my career. I fought once while I was 33, and it's ridiculous. So it's a big layoff for me, and I'm looking forward to breaking this layoff snap.
So you feel better when the busier you are by the sounds of it?
Absolutely. I'm going to be training no matter what. I might as well get paid for it at the end of it.
Fair enough.
Now, talk about your experience on The Ultimate Fighter. You were the first overall pick to Shane Carwin there.
Yeah, which is great. I wish I wouldn't have flopped out of that show so handedly. But being first pick was great. It was, I mean, how many Ultimate Fighters have there been? 25 of them? There's only 25 people in the history of the planet that have been picked first.
Yeah, on The Ultimate Fighter 2, did the reality TV aspect of it make it difficult?
No, it was just, and people hate this answer, but it was really boring. It was 6 weeks of hanging around fighters and talking about fighting. And you get nothing else to break up the monotony. You're just kind of bored all the time. Then you get to kind of work out once or twice a day, and then you get to be bored again. I was very happy when it ended.
Fair enough.
Now, what got you into MMA in the first place?
I stumbled into MMA. I never meant to do this. Someone said, hey, there's a cage. You want to fight in it? And I said, yeah. And then eventually I ended up in the UFC. It's been a long career. I love what I do. There's nothing I would rather do, but I never meant to do this. I didn't grow up watching boxing or watching MMA, or I didn't know what the UFC was until I had 6 or 7 fights as a professional. I was just good at hitting people, and so I kept doing it.
That's how awesome. Old were you the first time you stepped into the gym for MMA?
22. I think my first fight was 21. First time I trained at all, I was probably 22.
Wow.
What was that first fight look like? Like you hadn't trained.
Yeah, I think the guy's name was Eldridge, John Eldridge, something Eldridge. Yeah, I don't know. I just stepped in, and I never knew there was training for it. It's just, you know, the movies make it look so easy, so I figured I'd go in and do that. I knocked him out real well. I knocked him down real quick, and then I didn't know the rules, and so I, you know, celebrated. Then he got back up and beat me up. but it was a good first round. And then after that, I just kept going, and I think it was like 11 or 12 fights in a row. I won or knocked him out. Turned pro somewhere in there. Still wasn't training. It was probably just before my first loss as a professional before I actually started training.
Wow. Now, what advice?
Safe to say you're almost like a natural if you were able to do so well without the training originally.
It was a different sport back then. Back then, it really was whoever was the toughest kind of won. Nowadays, I don't know if I would have had, if I'd have the same luck just stepping into a cage. But I always hit hard. I don't know where that came from, and I've always been able to take a punch. So I've got a couple things genetically correct with me.
Fair enough.
Now, what advice would you give to the young athlete looking to get into MMA?
If you're real good at baseball, play baseball instead. That would be my best advice. But if your MMA is where you're at, wrestle. Find a team to wrestle with. MMA wrestling is not enough. Find a wrestling team and wrestle.
That's good.
That's fair. And now we have a fan question here. So shout out to Brock. He wanted to know who has the hardest punch of anybody that you fought so far.
I think Nate Marquardt. I mean, outside of Dan Henderson. Dan Henderson, hands down, there's not a close second. But I've never actually fought him. I've only sparred with him. Okay. In the actual octagon, it was probably Nate Marquardt. I've been hit before. You know, I've been finished twice. But both of those finishes, I wasn't really hit that hard. It was just a bad stoppage kind of thing. Nate Marquardt hit me, and it shook my life for a couple of weeks.
Fair enough.
Wow. Now, we see on your record that you have won no contest because of rainfall. What's the story behind that?
Yeah, so I, back in Wisconsin, I used to fight for King of the Cage all the time up at Lake of the Torches Casino, which is way up north in Wisconsin. So we went up there, and they had this big outdoor arena kind of thing. And I was supposed to fight Paul Bradley. And during the co-main event, it started raining. So I was like, oh, okay. The promoter came up and said, hey, if you guys fight anyways, it'll be a no contest, but we'll give the winner an extra $1,000. I said, yeah, let's do it. Let's do it. So we went out there, and round one, it was just pouring on us. We were soaked. The mat was soaked. We couldn't stand up. He came in. I hit him. He fell over. Then I fell over. And then he crambled on. We just spent one round kind of slipping and sliding all around. At the end of round one, the promoter, I guess. Yeah, it wasn't the promoter, but the Indian casino sports guy. He came came in and put a stop to it. I said, no, okay, you guys are done. You guys are going to get, like, really hurt through the water. We'll split the $1,000. Yeah, so Paul Bradley and I made an extra $500 getting to roll around and in the rain. It was like a movie scene. It was just downpouring.
Mm-hmm.
And it was pretty cool.
That's an awesome story. Yeah, well, we really appreciate you coming on here. We want to wish you good luck on your fight May 9th. We hope it happens. We're pretty, sounds pretty confident that's going to happen, and we hope you put on a great showcase.
Hey, I appreciate that, guys. Thank you so much for having me on. And next time I'm on, I'll make sure I have video. I'm sorry I don't this time.
No worries, man. Yeah, sounds good, man, eh? Have a good weekend.
All right, we'll talk to you later, fellas.
Once again, we'd like to thank Sam Alvey for taking his time out of his day to come on the podcast. It was really interesting to talk to him, especially about how he's dealt with the coronavirus and about this new fight coming up and kind of the weird circumstances surrounding it. We'd also like to thank Phoenix Fit, as this interview was brought to you by Phoenix Fit. I'll tell you a little bit about them. They're formulated by athletes for athletes. Their mission is to provide fuel for greatness. They're built for strength, engineered for endurance, and designed for recovery. Their supplements provide the necessary fuel to help you rise from the ashes. And every time a purchase is made at phoenixfit.com, that's spelled FNXFit.com, a child in need receives 1 gallon of clean water. To date, they've donated over 103,825 gallons of clean drinking water. So check right below here.
Not below Brad, below me.
And if you're listening on the podcast, check out either our Instagram for the link or in the bio for the podcast. You'll find the link there. Make sure to use our promo code BGT15 for 15% off your purchase. And let us know what you think of the product. And if you have any questions, hit us up. We'll be happy to tell you about them.
Yeah, and one thing from that interview, how cool was that rainout story?
I was not expecting that. That was super cool.
And like when I saw, when we were looking through his record, and I think you saw rainout, I was like, there's got to be a story behind that. So I'm glad we asked that question. Really great. And thank you again to Brock for his fan question. That was excellent.
We appreciate it, Brock.
Love you, Brock. And say hi to Bryce for us.